Ladies and gentlemen, hello and welcome on back to the ESL One Manila. We're here in the grand finals. We made it through absolutely every single qualifier that they've thrown our way. We've made it through the, you know, open qualifier where we got teams from all around all of the land cafes all throughout the Philippines. And they came together for, eight teams. They had a tournament themselves to be able to determine who went on to face the qualifying teams, the ones that were invited. And then they ended up making it through that one. And now the two stand supreme in the land where the ESL One Manila is going to take place, and it's Mineski facing off against TNC. I'm Lyrical Dota, joined today by Scant Sir. We saw some stuff that was pretty crazy last time around, and TNC this time are opting to go for the Nature's Prophet. What do you think about this response?
It's huge. I mean, the draft was very significant in the first game. That was where Mineski had first pick. Mineski first picked Nature's Prophet. Now TNC had first pick. They first picked Nature's Prophet. And the Sura is, before the Sura became one of the most important heroes at the Shanghai Major, the Sura was already one of the most important heroes in Southeast Asian Dota. So in some respect, Southeast Asia is a scene ahead in that trend. And for very good reason, because it's a hero that can split push, but it can also team fight, can also join the five-man push. I mean, historically, that's how the hero has always been used, but the sort of tempo of the top Dota in Southeast Asia really, like, exhibits a new level of fury on play, which we've seen now more generally around the world. But I think in terms of controlling the pace of the early game, it's probably the key hero. Enchantress is also a big one, though. Mineski do respond with that. And they also preemptively take the Witch Doctor, which deals very well with the Lone Druid, certainly. So it's going to be interesting. I mean, I honestly feel like the first game was decided very heavily by the draft. I think that TNC's draft to AU is actually probably a slightly stronger draft than Raging Potato. But I think that sometimes if you're the stronger drafter, that also gives you the weakness of being more predictable, because you know, when you're setting the way to draft, then it's easier for other people to study you and be like, okay, well, this is what you're going to do. Time. We'll have a plan to deal with it. So one of the other strengths of a really good draft is being able to adapt. And so the test here is to see if AU can do that.
I completely agree with you. And I think that already going for that first pick Nature's Prophet is a good adaption to it. And I would imagine that if they don't end up being able to get, you know, first pick as we move forward into this tournament, we might see Nature's Prophet banned out in the first phase as opposed to some of those other heroes. But the other ones that have been banned out this time, again, the draft moving fairly quickly, the Chen as well as the Bounty Hunter Beastmaster and the Batrider, that led us to the first pick Nature's Prophet, Enchantress and Witch Doctor, and then preempting that was going to be able to counter out slightly the Lone Druid, which is the second take for TNC. It didn't work out incredibly well for them last time. Again, they got a little bit of a later Radiant, but that was mainly because they had lost all their towers by that point. They had pretty much lost the game. I still like the hero a lot, but the big problem that I do feel like he sometimes suffer from is early aggression that sort of kicks in before he's able to get that Radiance up. And with an Enchantress and Witch Doctor, that's something you got to be somewhat prepared for.
Yeah, I mean, look, honestly, if you look at the early game of the previous game, TNC had, like, five heroes that do nothing early on in the game. It's like, Sprint Break is not going to do anything as a, you know, like, you're trying to roam on people, but the rest of your team's not doing well. You've got a Jungle Doom, which gets killed early on before even getting to, like, make his own rotations. You've got a support Vengeful Spirit that's, again, on its own, support Vengeful Spirit is really not that potent. And then Voker was losing its lane, and the Lone Druid has to farm to Radiance, so for me, the big pick, even though Nature's Prophet I think is huge, Earth Spirit is also very big here, because this kind of guarantees to some extent that TNC know that they can't be that greedy. They don't want to be pushed out of the game before it even starts for them.
Yeah, I think that they really need to make sure that they're able to put themselves in a position to win. I like the Earth Spirit pick. Vengeful Spirit, kind of interesting as well. I think that it's just another one of those. Like, the thing about this that I always look at is, what if Mineski now just go back for, like, two other heroes that can solo, and they go, like, an aggressive tri-lane with this combo? It would be so freaking scary to go up against. It's also worth noting they did ban out the Gyrocopter, OD, Jakiro, and the Broodmother, so no cheese. The Jakiro's kind of an interesting one as well. It's kind of been seen throughout the course of this tournament, and I think it's been going on for about a month, maybe two or so, where Jakiro's been picked up more and more frequently.
In the mid lane, he plays it's like, actually, TNC, their preferred push strategy at the moment is with the mid Jakiro, so I think it's Mineski showing that they've done their research to balance.
Yeah. Well, and I think the Weaver here as well, some people have said that this is mainly to try and deal with the Lone Druid. Do you believe that this hero works pretty well against the Lone Druid in the sort of mid-game?
I mean, the Weaver against the Lone Druid in the mid game, I don't think is a counter. I think the Weaver lanes pretty well against the Lone Druid. That's for me, at least historically, when I've thought about Weaver against Lone Druid, I feel like it's one of the few heroes that could actually win the 1v1 lane. So maybe like what you're talking about, if you end up wanting to leave other heroes somewhere else, well, in this case, it's almost certain that TNC are going to run safe lane Lone Druid. So I don't know if that would be off lane Weaver or... I mean, there's an argument to be made the Weaver is good against the Lone Druid in the mid game. Mostly just because the Lone Druid likes to be able to like get stuck on someone, and Weaver's very slippery. But I think with the Earth Spirits and the Lion, TNC will definitely have answers to deal with the Weaver. And again, look at the Earth Spirit, the Lion, and the Nature's Prophet. Compared to last game, TNC had a solo support Vengeful Spirits, a Jungle Doom, and an offlane Spirit Breaker. And I just feel like the three heroes they have here are much more guaranteed to have early game impact than the three heroes they had in the previous game, which, fair enough, actually, against a lot of opponents recently with those kind of heroes, Vengeful Spirit, Spirit Breaker, and Doom, which they actually use actively, can actually be very involved. But Mineski just like got ahead of them. The timing is just so important in this matchup, like which teams things start happening slightly earlier than the other teams, because it's for either the team, there's so much momentum that once you're ahead, it's very difficult for the other team to sort of creep back in and still hit their own timing. 10 seconds
remaining. Yeah, no, I would agree. I kind of am curious though. You said there that, and I would agree with you that Earth Spirit, Lion, Nature's Prophet, they are heroes that tend to allow you to fight more often in the earlier stages of the game. But one of the ways, whenever I think about Earth Spirit as a hero, that he can work really well is by, you know, roaming into the mid lane, trying to get that rolling boulder gank off. If we do end up seeing Mineski go for something like that aggro tri-lane, oh god, the aggro tri-lane, which Radiant I don't think we're going to necessarily be seeing now, but regardless, it kind of holds true nonetheless. Does this put the pressure on TNC to force Earth Spirit to be stuck to one of those lanes? Like, is he going to have the liberty to be able to go around, or does he have to stick in a lane to try and support a particular hero here?
I'm not too sure. Honestly, if I'm TNC right now, I'm trying to figure out what's mid for Mineski. I think the Weaver might actually be mid. And this is... their mid's going to be Teehee on the Phantom Lancer. I think draw range is a risky pick here, because TNC are, like, the most expert team at using draw ranger, definitely in the region, probably in the whole world, and will have a very good understanding of what they don't like it to be against. And honestly, Phantom Lancer is a godlike pick here. Like, this is a... if Phantom Lancer gets to Diffusal Blade this game, I almost feel like that's okay, that's it for Mineski. They can't do anything. Like, I use Diffusal Blade just as a placeholder, but there aren't direct ways for Mineski to deal with the PL. What is their best answer to it? They're going to get a gust preemptively and then stun it and attack it? Or...
The only thing that I could think about is like maybe eventually trying to, or you try and build up enough net worth maybe to the point where you can remaining. Like build into the Drow Ranger Aghanims or something like that. That's the only other thing that I could think about. Which, I mean, honestly, if it goes late, that's probably one of the best instances of picking up that. I don't know if it's necessarily good or not, but it's certainly something. Regardless, though, definitely going to be a very different feeling game than we saw before. And based upon the picks here, it looks like it actually might end up being Enchantress go to the mid lane. Raging Potatoes on the Weaver. I don't know if they decide to switch things up or not, but regardless, as I mentioned, Raging Potato is going to be playing the Weaver this time. It's Jesse Vash on the Witch Doctor. Ben here is going to be on the Enchantress. Lyle is going to be on the Drow Ranger. And last but not least is Jules on the Ventral Spirit. And would you care to introduce those fine folks on the southwest side of the map?
It's a five-man smoke for TNC, and Teehee is going to be on his signature Phantom Lancer with Winter G Small Sun on his signature Lion. He calls himself Pyladine Pubs these days, and there's a good reason for that. He likes to play Lion. Sam H, again, a signature hero, Nature's Prophet. AU also very comfortable on the Earth Spirits, and Raven very recently has been playing a lot of this Lone Druid.
Well, they're going to walk up to Hill. They are going to be able to find out the Venture Spirit. Not quite in range, but oh my goodness, never mind. We don't need to talk about range. That's an Earth Spirit that is in this game. Jules is going to die, and they end up throwing that first blood the way of Teehee. So pretty nice little start to this one. That's what you want to end up having happening for your team. They're just going to do a little moonwalk on out of the jungle, secure themselves a rune, and feeling pretty comfortable.
Yeah, so I was thinking that they might run the Weaver mid because it's not that easy to kill with the Earth Spirit ganks. But I figure that that's actually the reason they ran the Enchantress mid, because the Weaver actually, once Earth Spirit's able to silence, will be able to probably make those kills, whereas the Enchantress, I think it's going to be very difficult for Earth Spirit and PL to make those kills on Enchantress.
Yeah, I would agree with you there. The bear is taking a good chunk of damage here, and it is going to end up being the Enchantress picking up the rune. They're still going to be looking for the kill here. No poof away, and that's actually just a nice little 300 chunk of gold going their direction. A little bit odd, but it ends up working out somewhat.
The way the timings of this game work for me is there's still some room for Mineski to just, like, overrun with the draw aura, in the sense that, like last game, Lundruid's going to be farming a Midas and a Radiance, and he's going to be, like, a lot less relevant until he hits that timing. PL to some extent is similar, even though TE's a very active PL, until he gets to his first important item, Defusal Blade, or maybe even just the drum early on, also going to be in a similar position. So I think there's that window. I think if we see Mineski having a really solid early game like they did last game, really taking a big lead in the first 10 minutes, then they probably look good. But if that doesn't happen, then I really think they're in a lot of trouble. And I think there's signs that the opposite could happen. Look at this mid lane. Attempt to kill the Enchantress, but she's level 2. She's not going
to
die.
Oh my goodness. And they might be able to kill off this PL, actually. She has her attendants. He didn't have a doppelganger there, but wisely, with her spirit being in the area, he's going to force her back for the moment. Ben here still trading hits. My goodness, she is very, very quick. And Teehee is going to be forced out again. This Enchantress mid is causing a lot of trouble and just salves on up. Man, this is really working for them.
AU missed his role, but I think they probably wouldn't have killed anyway. In fact, they might have been baited to die.
Wow.
And that's a kill on the lion and the bot lane as well, with the aggressive dual lane being very aggressive. I mean, it's like Weaver and Witch Doctor is much, much stronger than Lundruid and lion early on. And this is going to kind of tear the Earth Spirit's attention of, do I need to be bot all the time? Do I need to be mid all the time? They have the Nature's Prophet who can also jump around, and that's what he's doing right now, and I think this will be a kill, a return kill on the Witch Doctor.
He does have the cask, but not opting to use it, instead just gonna walk his way out of there and try and end up dying. But yeah, I agree with you. It's kind of one of those things I was wondering about in the draft, is we're gonna see Teehee try and mess around a little bit here, is how effectively is this Earth Spirit actually gonna be able to roam? Because if he leaves, you end up seeing that the lion dies down in the bottom lane, and he ends up being able to come down, and they apply a little bit of pressure. They kill the Witch Doctor, who is slightly out of position. But it feels like that's this push and pull that goes back and forth with this hero, and he wants to be everywhere at once because there he can find kills. But if he leaves anywhere at all to go into a place where he can find a kill, I just feel like this Earth Spirit's rotations have to be so effective.
The Courier Snipe is coming. The Courier Snipe.
Are they going to get it? Oh man, that really hurts. 800 right here at the start. Oh man, that sucks.
And this is what Mineski did so well last game. They recognized that Teehee is meant to have a very important early game. It's a very big deal for TNC.
Curses!
And Witch Doctor just denies himself the entrance, but Teehee has to run all the way to base now. He's had a difficult lane matchup. He's used to playing the PL against heroes he can just stand around and trade hits with and then lance and go for the kill, but it's Enchantress, you can't really do that. Now he's lost his bottle. Has to run to base, and I think that for TNC, the early game is going to be a lot on the effect of the Earth Spirits and the Nature's Prophets. Like, Lion, I said, is useful, but it's useful in connection with other heroes. It needs a lot of levels. Lundruid really needs the levels in the farm. So I think there's just pressure on AU and Sam to keep TNC in a decent position till the sort of 15-minute mark, and if they're there, then I think they look pretty strong, but so far Mineski making a lot of important moves to deny that.
This is going to be pretty low right now on the Enchantress, but still, the Nature's Attendants keep her alive, and she is just so freaking hard to kill in any of these engagements. I will also say that they've got this little 3-minute pull that come through. I thought they were going to just try and go for the single pull and then pressure the tower, but they lost their catapult, and so they're going to be going for the connection instead, and this does end up meaning they're going to have a decent chunk of experience taken away from them, but also maybe in a little bit of trouble. They can maybe think about even diving under the tower again to see if they can kill that lion again. But level 2, he's probably a little bit more stable than he was previously. Witch Doctor's going to run into him. I mean, we're taking a look at the last hits and eyes, and you can see the lone druid fairly far behind the Drow Ranger, and I think all of these lanes are going pretty well for Mineski, but is it going well enough? Like, we've talked about this sort of ticking time bomb for Teehee. Do you think that... Oh, man, he actually might just die, though. Oh, the last second doppelganger. The chase is going to continue. Ben here trying to run after him. He does have enough mana for a lance, but... God, she is just completely and totally bullying him out of this lane.
Yeah, he's been completely dominated. Like, the one thing that would have kept him, sort of brought him back into the lane, was getting his bottle. It is like I mean, we always talk about career snipes early on being a big deal, but this is kind of the perfect career snipe where sometimes getting your bottle just kind of like adds a little bit of extra, but this is, okay, top lane draw range is going to go down, so somewhere else on the map, TNC getting a lot of value. But they're going to have to buy that space for TE at some point.
That's really nice too, because obviously it means that now it's not quite as much pressure for this little bit of time when Draw Ranger's dead, and it all helps out a little bit. And I think that getting that kill there was really important. You take a look at the net worth, as it is. I mean, Enchantress is top of the mark. You've also got your Draw Ranger there and a Weaver. But the wraparound behind the tower, they are not going to spot this out, as the ward is still there but hasn't seen him yet. So they're calling it
good. You wanted to replace the ward, I think, because that ward's about to run out. So I think Jesse Vash was hoping to get a new one up.
And AU is actually spotting him as well. They end up going for that D ward, so they are going to be able to spot it. He actually doesn't take it down. He doesn't have any way to be able to take it down. The tangos are going to be
It's about a time up.
Oh my goodness, that was really close. Nicely done, though. He ends up getting that little extra bit of gold and experience, which helps out a lot.
But yeah, it's the bottle's there now. The courier get respawned, and they're going to try and get a kill on this Enchantress, but I think this is going to be extremely difficult, even with all three heroes.
Ooh, and
even with an Aegis Prophet.
They're going to spot him out, so they're going to have to take a consolation kill here. I don't think the Enchantress is going to stick around to get ganked, and yeah, they're just going to move out.
Honestly, that's much better for TNC. I think there's a very good chance if they go on the Enchantress, she doesn't even die. So I think it's really good for them that they managed to run to the Witch Doctor.
Well, they end up being able to pick up that one kill, and still heroes are farming. I mean, that was three heroes committed for that one. Granted, it was the Lion and the Earth Spirit, and we were talking about the need for them to be able to be mobile and find kills in this lane, in any lane, honestly, and they've been able to do it to some extent. So 4-1 is the score so far. I will say the difference in terms of team net worth, it's about 1,500 into the favor of Mineski right now. So it's a little bit difficult, but I don't think it's by any means over at all. It's not even necessarily a clear lead, but probably just how these rotations end up paying off is going to be the most important factor.
Yeah, I mean, there's an important timing coming up. And we see a Vengeful Spirit TP for the bot lane. I think Drow Ranger might TP down there soon as well, right after getting level 6. This is what Drow strats do early on. They go for a bunch of towers, and normally it's quite important to see if the team against the Drow strategy has any response. Can they get a trade of towers? Can they fight the Drow strategy? Right now it's not too... The big difficulty is dealing with the Enchantress, actually.
Yeah. Well, and they're hiding out here. It does look like Drow is going to end up moving down the area. It's worth noting that the Nature's Prophet is trading towers up top. Enchantress ends up taking the mid one, but they are going to be able to take the tower on the top of the side of TNC. It's going to take a little while, but maybe going to be able to find out Raven now. Oh god, the cask is bouncing, and he is going to end up going down. I believe they find the kill despite the Nature's Prophet ulti. They weren't able to punish it, and it looks like they're going to end up losing two towers for the price of one. We do have the heal that's here for the Witch Doctor, and they could think about maybe exploiting his low HP, but anybody TPing in there would have been instantly dead, and they're going to keep the pressure on up top here.
Yeah, it's a mistake by Raven not having a TP scroll. He should have been able to get out of there when he realized they're not going to be able to defend. It's good for TNC that they managed to get the top tower. They lose mid and bot, but mid tower is really low anyway, so in some senses it's still just 1-for-1. And if they can keep trading towers against the draw strategy, this is something that, again, like, TNC are experts in draw, and I think that they know that one of the biggest ways to deal with the draw is to make, every time the draw strat assembles, make it into a trade instead of just a free tower.
Yeah, absolutely, and they're absolutely doing that. We have the Earth Spirit down here as well to try and, you know, keep them off of their tier 2 for the moment. The Nature's Prophet flirting with TPing in. He's thinking about it, but keeps on canceling it out for the moment. They throw out the Nature's Attendant. Ben here silence, but they get the Gust off as well, and it does look like they're going to call it off for the moment. A little bit of a chase forward. They ended up trading off the towers 2-for-2, but calling it good for the moment. They're going to end up TPing back home and dealing with the pressure that was coming from the Radiant.
I mean, it's a good decision by TNC to make the trades, but the trades are still favorable for Mineski to like. Obviously, Mineski would rather have their kill towers and don't lose any. But in terms of like the, because they're hitting an earlier timing in their draft, both teams getting gold is better for them as long as they make use of the timing when they get to it. Because Lohendruid's going to take a big gap to get to his Radiance, and Phantom Lance is very far from having a Diffusal Blade. And those are sort of the timings where Mineski gets into big trouble and maybe struggle to win the game. But they've got a lot of time in between now, and then they've got a Dragonlance now, and they're either Drow sending the Morbid Maw so she can farm the jungle more effectively. And the next time for TNC is actually level 6 in their supports, because both of the Earth Spirits level 6 makes it much more difficult for Mineski to push and not risk losing a fight, and the Lion's level 6, which he's already got now, is suddenly you can kill Enchantress, which I think is gigantic.
Well, I will say that the thing that's kind of the problem with that is, of course, is that, like, if you look at Mineski, like, you still are a little ways away from the level 6 on the Earth Spirit, which means that his teamfight potential isn't going to be as much as it was before. And I think that you're right. They are going to be going for that kill now with the Lion. But they have been really hemmed in as far as the levels go. The Drow strat has been as well, but I think that it's less important for them because it's much more just about the right-click damage that comes out. I'm curious what you think about this Weaver's item pickup. You went for the straight Dragonlance after the Treads and the Aquila. Is that just sort of by virtue of getting the bonus damage, or what do you think is his thinking behind this?
It's very good. I mean, Weaver always wants cheap early pickups, usually something to make you tanky, and it'll be able to disassemble for BKB later, and the quarterstaff's definitely going to be useful, so I think it's great.
They're going to roam on in now. There's Sakuchi on through everybody. A decent chunk of damage. Teehee going to be able to take it. The impetus shot today as well. Mammoth throwing out the cast. Not quite going to be there in time. They swap back out. Jules maybe in a little bit of trouble. He's going to start dropping fairly low. Finger of Death down. That's going to be able to kill off the Venge and now going to chase further. Raven is still out. They throw out the Savage Roar, keeping them alive for the moment. Oh my god. Raging Potato is doing so much damage. Chases after Teehee. He's going to go for the TP. They do have the cast. It's not going to be able to be there in time. And because of that, he's going to be able to escape. They do lose the bear in the mid lane, so 2-for-1 trade so far. My goodness, that is a little bit nuts.
It's really good by Jules to swap himself in there, not just because he swapped Nature's Prophet in for the kill, but swap yourself into the front lines, and what ends up happening is that Lion doesn't feel comfortable going past the Vanish to finger someone else. Lion uses the stun and the finger on the Vengeful Spirit, and that's exactly not what they needed. The importance of getting level 6 on Lion is that now they can take out the Weep or the Drow or the Enchantress easily, but if you're going to use your combo on a Vengeful Spirit that's already used to swap in a stun, it's just not good value at all for the Lion's contribution to the fight.
Well, it does look like now with that, though, they're going to be able to take on down that Aegis, and they're going to have it up on the Enchantress. So, you know, you mentioned the Lion there wanting to be able to finish her off, and maybe the finger being used on the Vengeful Spirit not as much value as it would be otherwise. Now they don't even have the option to do it on the Enchantress, because that's just going to be a burn through the Aegis. So, I don't know. This is starting to look more and more like Mineski are going to take control of this game. But the question is that ticking time bomb, the PL, does he end up being able to get enough items up? It looks like he's going for a couple more of these small ones along the way. Already has the Aquila. Treads completed, and now a Bracer. Maybe thinking about drums? What do you think about that item choice?
I think he wants to be online as soon as possible. I think that it's at this point it's too greedy to rush the Diffusal Blade, especially considering the fact that the Lone Druid is going to be trying to save for the Radiance. And this is the thing, you talk about Ticking Time Bomb, they both are actually. Both of them are quite difficult to deal with in the context of a team fight. Like, obviously Lone Druid against Drow strategy, you can just all stand and attack the Spirit Bear or attack the Lone Druid, but if the whole team's there and if there's the Savage Roar, it's very difficult. So this, for me, this is still a game where I feel like overall TNC's lineup, if it reaches the sort of 30-35 minute mark and it's looking reasonably healthy, it's probably won the game. And I think Teehee recognizing that is like, well, okay, I've got to do what I can to be relevant right now, because the Lone Druid actually just doesn't have that option.
Yeah. Well, and I think that, you know, if this does end up turning out Mineski's way again, and obviously that's thinking far ahead to the future with a lot of things having to go right for them, it would feel to me at least like potentially another draft win just based upon how quickly all of these heroes have come online. And I'm concerned now about TNC's ability to hold off. It feels like they're making the trades happen. Like, you look here in the mid lane, TE and Spirit Bear, they're right cooking away on this tower, but can they actually get out? Can they escape from this one? With the haste rune, it does look like they're going to be able to, and that just pulls them apart. So they're making all of the correct plays, but are the correct plays enough to make it happen and make them come away with the win? That's the real question that I have.
If this ends up being an outdraft, like, or an out gimmick or whatever, it's very much on TNC themselves, because remember, they last picked the Phantom Lancer. They've already seen every other hero, and I think,
up top, AU's just gonna drop. They caught a mid-roll with this stun coming out from Jesse Vash, and that was as well as ultimate committed. That's gonna just turn around and drops the Witch Doctor ulti. Vash is trying to TP away, but not gonna be able to make it happen. It looks like the Weaver
gets caught too.
They're going to be able to get the Hex off. There's the Earth Spike. There's going to be a lot of damage coming out. He just explodes. Looking for one more kill there. Enchantress is so scary. Phase Boots committed, and it looks like Sam might end up going down himself. Can she get the impetus off? Not going to be there in time. And they end up being able to make it work. Really nicely played there, and right around 1,200 gold swing.
Yeah, it's a big win for TNC. But what I was saying before that is, they lost pick Phantom Lancers, so they knew all the heroes, and they obviously just didn't expect it to be Enchantress Mid, or if they expected it, they didn't think it would be so difficult. They thought maybe Earth Spirit would be enough to deal with the lane, but yet again, two games in a row, we see Teehee, the player who, like, almost always, I would say it's the most sure thing for TNC that he wins his lane. It seems like no matter what matchup they give him, he just manages to win it, and two games in a row, he's really been destroyed in his lane. This time, even with him getting attention from his supports and the enemy not. So, if it ends up looking like an outdraft, that's like most definitely the thing that needs to be focused on.
Yeah, well, looks like for the moment at least, they're going to keep the pressure on. Don't tell he dropped down the ground again. Aegis is available with the Dragonlance, Drums, Phase Boots, and the Wand. You've got Drow Ranger herself, who already has the Yasha up on top of a Helm of the Dominator, so is going to be able to get those stacks off, and I think that she did already take one set of them, but it's so scary at this point. Like, they have pretty much everything that they could want. This is the second to last tier 2 tower, and going to be able to just right-click it down with all of these ranged heroes. So much damage, and I mean, you look right now at the Vengeful Spirit Princess, she's getting 55 damage, all of their heroes are, from this aura. It's a ridiculous amount, and the Geminate attack only doubles down on it. By the way, it does look like Weaver, do you feel like this might end up being a Lincoln Sphere game for him?
That's sort of the default go-to item on Weaver, and especially if the enemy team has a lan, I think that's what you need to get, so it's where he'll be heading for sure. I like the fake back from Mineski, hoping to get a pickoff, maybe with a swap, and if they get a big pickoff, it actually could turn into getting base.
It looks like AU is still sitting up there, Mr. Earth Spirit. They're looking maybe for a wave of terror into something, but at least for now, TNC isn't biting. They realize that this could be going on, and they're just hanging out for the moment. They back
Do you
out.
See the pings? Their ward showed the courier fly over because they have a ward in the mid lane. And so they're like, okay, we know where you are.
A clue. they find that. And they do have a ward now on the Eventual Spirit, so going to place that behind there so they can spot people out. But TP away, make sure she's not going to get taken out. And again, just doing what they need to do. Mineski is up by about 5,000 gold, but this hasn't translated into huge items yet, and I think that that's really what you need to be able to convincingly sort of snowball throughout the rest of the game, is at least one item advantage, because otherwise the net worth lead doesn't really matter all that much.
Yeah, and much more importantly, if we compare this to the previous game, TNC are going to get all their key items before the game ends this game. It looks like PL is definitely going to be able to finish Diffusal Blade very soon, actually. It needs about 500 gold. Lone Druid's already about to have Relic. Lion's actually not that far from Blink Dagger, so the previous game there was this issue where TNC were close to their item timings only when they were like already two sides of Rax down, like about to lose the game. Right. But now they're going to get to have fights defending their base before it gets to even the question of Rax with all the key items, and I think that's a dramatically different dynamic.
Totally. Well, it's something where even still going into that last game, if they had all their items, it didn't feel like they were going to be able to do it, but they at least have a fighting chance now. They have ways to outplay their opponents. There's possibilities for them to actually take some, you know, advantage back in this game, and I think that, you know, they're entirely capable of doing it, and probably at this point in time, they feel much more comfortable than they did previously. It's also worth noting, and we talked about this a little bit at the beginning of game number one, TNC are coming off of a best of three that they just played about 45 minutes before game one, and it was a 2-0 stomp for them, but regardless, you know, this is a best of five after a best of three. These are some things that people might want to consider a little bit.
Yeah, for sure. Might make you need to like ease into the next series. Could bring you into the series maybe a bit too confident. Could explain being outdrafted, surprised in the first game, maybe even to some extent the second game. But honestly, I think it's an understatement to say that TNC have something to fight for. They're still in it. Like, if they get to their Radiance timing, the Lion Blink Dagger, they've already got the PL Diffusal Blade. At that point, if they win one fight very convincingly, I think they're substantially ahead in this game.
Yeah.
But for now, Mineski realized that their timing window is closing and they go for the high ground.
My goodness, they are pushing. very, very rapidly. There's no glyph right now, and I don't know if they're actually going to be back in time. Tier 2 tower falls in the mid lane, but they've already got Nature's Attendance out. They're going to start right-clicking down the Earth Spirit. He needs to be careful about his counter-initiation. Ben here is sprouted up, but fine for the moment. Two people caught on the Earth Spike. Nicely played there. The gust goes out, but it actually doesn't connect, and the Diffusal Blade is now down on top of Draw Ranger. They end up being able to break the TP there with the Savage Roar. A lot of damage coming back out. They need to be able to think about just getting out of here right now. And it does look like Raging Potato is going to be able to escape. Goes for the TP away. Oh, God, they guessed wrong. He was hiding behind that little tree, and they only get one for their trouble, but it is a pretty big one.
Yeah, so, I mean, TE gets onto his Mega Kill Streak, which will get him next toward another component of his next item. On top of his Diffusal Blade, he's going to finish his drum. They lose their axes, but I think it's actually just excellent decision-making from both teams. Mineski realizing they want to fight once they have Radiance, they want to fight once they have the Blink. Now, actually, both those items are up on TNC. So if the same situation played itself out again, TNC would commit a lot more. Whereas TNC there were sort of willing to lose their axes. They wanted to defend, but they didn't want to overcommit and then end up all dying and miss those item timings completely. But I think that the next fight is much more significant, actually. And it sounds almost ridiculous, but I think in this game, having one side of Rax is actually not that big a deal for either side.
No, I would agree completely. The biggest thing about it is just the gold that they were able to get, and then that translated into items. But you can see right now, I mean, it doesn't really matter all that much. Spirit Bear is sitting here with his Radiance. He's, you know, farming away, happy as a clam. And in the meantime, they're going to smoke on up and try and go for a kill. And he can do this the whole time because you can just poof him back in, and then you're going to be in the middle of the fight again, dealing a ton of damage. Aghanim Scepter just now picked up, but Jules is going to be caught out. It does look like he's going to go down, and I don't think Mineski can come and try and fight this at all. They need to back out now and try and make sure that they don't end up getting a set of racks taken of their own, because the whole time that we've been seeing this, they've been able to make these fights work for themselves. They've been able to take counter trades, and now they're pushing high ground of their own.
Lion's still got Blink, he's still got ulti, and if he gets a catch here, it could be really big.
Well, they buy back on the Vengeful Spirit, thinking about going for something along the lines of a swap. It is fairly long range. They're getting the extra movement speed right now. Weaver is chasing, does give the extra vision. Lincoln Spears pop. Now Silence is going to come out as well. Raging Potato maybe in a little bit of trouble, but they're throwing out the Finger of Death onto Ben here. He's dropping low, but still alive for the moment. The ultimate is bouncing around as well from the Earth Spirit. Already the Drow Rangers dead. They did kill off the Nature's Prophet, though, and it looks like they're going to be able to finish off the Enchantress. So two are dead now. On the bottom side, that's also going to be Raging Potato able to pick off the Lion. So two for two so far, but more importantly, it's the two cores from Mineski that are dead. With Lone Druid still up, they are going to take this tower very quickly.
Yeah, this is going to be a side of Rax. I think one side of Rax per team by the look of things. Witch Doctor does come in with the Cask, and this might be a mistake. Well, nothing to stop him because everyone's committing for the Vengeful Spirit.
Jules is going to die, though, and they get the Silence off in the end. Nicely played there. Oh, Raging Potato runs through, needs to be able to find this kill. Is not going to be able to make it work. Oh, God, an Earth Spirit gets away on nothing. Trying to kill off this bear as quickly as they can. They do lose the range, or the melee set of barracks, but I don't know if they're going to be able to kill off this bear. They throw out one more stun. They haven't actually broken it. It's just going to walk away. Oh, no, they don't even get the bear kill.
Yeah, so it was a really good decision by TNC when they were being chased out of the base. They stop at the high ground here, and they recognize Mineski's just going to chase us. We hold our ground and fight from the high ground advantage. We'll probably win the fight, and that's what they do. Leads to them taking our axe. And honestly, now with the Earth Spirit picking up a veil, I talked about all the other hero timings, but if you saw how much work Earth Spirit spells did in that fight, add the veil into that, it's looking closer and closer to Mineski really struggles with these fights, and they do the right thing. They go straight for the rush because they need an Aegis, but TNC already.
Doppelganger right there. They're going to be able to do a ton of damage. Drow Ranger's falling very quickly. Earth Spirit's in the middle of all of them as well. They're all going to end up going down right now. Raging Potato's been silenced up. It looks like they're going to be able to do this one. Mineski are in such a terrible position right now. Benny are bashed up by Rojiman, and now Diffusal Blade slowing him up. That's going to be a kill. Oh, God. This is going disastrously. They do manage to catch out Jesse Vash on the other side. He's trying to TP away. Wait, can they break it at all? There's the Savage Roar. He's going to end up dying. It did look like they finished off the Nature's Prophet. The two would end. They get the Silence off. They get the Sun off. That's going to be a dead Jesse Vash. And the only person left alive at this stage is the Vengeful Spirit, who had to go back to base. Honestly, at this point in time, buyback status, you don't have it on anybody. The only person with buyback is Witch Doctor. They're going to be able to take another set of racks here.
And this is what I was talking about. Now that TNC have won a big fight, never mind the fact that they get an Aegis with it, they're completely in control. They could win this game in the next 5 minutes. After like 10 minutes ago, they were pretty far behind. Now they, Mineski have almost nothing in this game, and all it took is hitting those item timings, winning like 1.5 important fights. And it's Mineski now need to look for like some kind of cheese play. Honestly, that's they don't straight up fighting or none of that stuff works. I mean, they're gonna kill the Aegis now, but so what?
That was maybe a little bit of an overextension by the PL, but as you said, he's still there, doppelgangers away, and is fine for the moment. And it looks like they're actually just gonna go back in. Oh my god, Draw Ranger, nothing to keep her safe that time. If they don't get the jump on these heroes, it's just not gonna end up working. And you see right now, he's just taking no damage from the Witch Doctor ultimate. The barracks are dropping in the top lane. They're TPing back in again, trying to see whatever they can catch, but the gust isn't gonna catch. They're not gonna be able to find them. They throw out the really long range impetus. This is gonna continue to chase out onto AU, trying to create enough space so that way Raven isn't gonna end up going down. The swap range is so close to be able to catch, but not quite gonna be there. Actually swaps out to get the stun off, but not gonna be able to be enough. The Earth Spike comes in from afar. And my goodness, that's two lanes of barracks. And right now Mineski are in a position, like, again, if they win a team fight, they can take the towers so quickly, but they're not in a position to win any of the fights now because of these items on TNC.
They should never win a fight. It's like, TNC have to make mistakes for them to win a fight. I mean, to be fair, and you pointed it out, TNC were actually quite cocky at the top racks. The PL just jumps in, loses the Aegis for pretty much nothing. But even being that cocky about it, and maybe slightly uncoordinated in what they were trying to do, they still get a racks. They still pretty much all get out alive. Most of them do anyway, and this is the advantage that they have there. The draw lineup has just like failed to achieve as much as it needed to with the timing window it had. Killing one side of Rax was not enough. It needed to kill three sides of Rax, or at least two sides of Rax. And yes, you're right. The draw lineup still has this kind of like, if somehow you wipe the enemy team and they can't buy back, you'll kill their buildings really quickly. Well done. But the first part of that plan is like, at this point, I feel like a 5% player.
Yeah. Well, and it feels like there's so many different problems with it. The control they have is single target or RNG based. The damage that they have is single target and, you know, contingent upon the opponents not being on top of you. And like the things that you need to deal with TNC's lineup are either super hard control preemptively, able to get the jump, which is not the strong suit of Mineski, or it's on the other side, AoE control, which isn't really what they have either. The only thing that I could potentially really see them gain back into this game with is just straight up out DPSing them. And honestly, that would require something along the lines of like a Drow Ags with Mjolnir, because they don't have the AoE damage that they need. It's just, it's not there. Although that being said, they are going for a push down here in the bottom lane. They've got, you know, a little Centaur Conqueror to give them an AoE stun. If they do manage to be able to push this out a little bit further, there's the potential that they can maybe start to slow siege down the high ground. Again, it's going to be so hard.
Weaver's got a Lincolns and a BKB. It's actually very, very difficult to deal with. Even with just the Lincolns, it was difficult for TNC to deal with the Weaver. So that's kind of going to be their plan. The Enchantress and the Weaver are both very difficult to kill.
Forward there, they swap him back out, so he's fine for the moment. BKB's still not popped, he is still holding on his ground, gonna be able to pop it now and trying to do as much damage as possible. They throw out the stun. Oh, but there's the Ghost Scepter keeping his buddy alive for the moment. Drow Ranger's already dead, so no bonus damage, and it looks like Teehee is gonna drop fairly low. Raging Potato doing as much as he can. Lincoln Sphere's still popped, and they don't have enough to be able to kill him off, but the silence is there. That's gonna keep him controlled. There's gonna be no time left, and he is gonna end up dying. They killed the PL, but they killed everybody else on the side of Mineski. And now the barracks are going down. There's the TP in from Sam. They're going to be able to sprout up Jesse Bash. And oh no, say it ain't so. They do get the Witch Doctor ultimate. Actually just going to be able to kill him off with the Maledict Bird. My goodness, that was an overextension.
Yeah, pretty unnecessary death actually from Sam. And he doesn't have the buyback. He's not rich enough. But yeah, the fights is, you can see what Mineski are thinking. Actually, the Weaver and the Enchantress are difficult to deal with. And if you have to deal with them up front, maybe you can somehow win a fight, like, just by sheer force of will and standing your ground and not dying. But TNC just goes straight on the draw. I mean, I don't actually know what Mineski's plan was for them to avoid them doing that, because the draw is actually very easy to deal with. So, and the you know, the draw is kind of a key component of the damage, giving the Weaver and the Enchantress the damage they have. So, if they find a way to take that kind of fight where you have to try and kill Enchantress or Weaver first, maybe they still have some kind of chance, but where does the Drow stand then? Is the Drow just like not even coming to the fight? Because then they have the problem of just having less heroes in the fight.
Toilet weight. What a guy. I think that it's worth thinking about. Like, at least, you know, at some points in the games, teams would just leave a silencer in their base in the fountain because they didn't want, there was no reason for him to leave at all. Sure, they would have been able to get a little bit of extra DPS, but honestly, at a certain point, like, getting the extra damage, you look at what the Venge is getting right now from her aura, 55 damage, you throw that onto the Weaver, and all of a sudden, he's hitting for about 200 a pop, and then you add in on top of that the Geminate attack damage because it's two of them. Like, I completely think it's worth it to, you know, essentially have an extra 100 damage that comes out, and you leave the Drow Ranger at home. They have enough damage from the right clicks from everybody else.
Well, the problem is that because they're so far behind, if they leave a hero behind, even though it's like in theory good to protect the Drow, to protect everyone's damage, suddenly Lion's jumping either Enchantress or Weaver. Now you have one hero. Because the Venge and the Witch Doctor are not going to win your fight. Like, the damage output has to be from the Enchantress and the Weaver. If the Lion catches one of those heroes and the Drow's not there, there's one hero left. And I just think that TNC are so far ahead that one of those heroes on their own will simply never win a fight right now. So that's why I think it's almost like a catch-22. Like, you need to find a way for the Drow to be part of the fight, but impossible for them to go on the Drow. And I don't think there is any way to do that. I think TNC, like I said, are absolute experts on this hero. They know very well how to deal with the Drow, and they will be finding the Drow in those fights absolutely every time.
Maybe one of the ways that they could think about doing it is using more with the swap, because that last game, you know, they swapped out the Weaver when he, like, after he popped his BKB, or right before he popped his BKB, actually. He was silenced up, but it felt like maybe that's a little bit of a waste. If you can afford to save that swap to keep the Drow out of harm's way for at least a little while, then maybe you put yourself in a position where she can still be a part of the fight, but not be as vulnerable. Like, there's no way you're going to be able to cover her completely, but maybe you make her slightly less vulnerable. But in the meantime, Jules is trying to TP away. That's not going to happen.
Well, the swap plan can't work without the Vengeful Spirits. And I don't think TNC are going to wait 40 seconds. I think they're just going to march up into the base and start killing buildings.
And that seems to be the predominant strategy, and it's going to work pretty freaking well. They got AC already up on the bear. It's a 12k net worth lead after it was roughly about 8,000 or so going the other direction. And every item in the world that they could possibly want. Raging Potato does jump through, trying to chase after the Raven here, but not going to be able to make it happen. And they end up being able to get the Hex off. The right clicks are there. Can they finish off this Weaver? Still trying to run away. They end up time-lapsing back. Fine for the moment. Trying to turn back around and do as much damage as possible, but they're not going to be able to kill off the bear. AU dropping low. Maledic damage is there as well. Are going to be able to finish him off with the Impetus. Trying to chase after Winter Small Sun, but they haven't been able to get him. And the Weaver's already dead now. They jump forward onto the Drow Ranger. GG ends up getting called, and TNC strike back. They managed to take game number two here in a pretty well-deserved fashion. Like, it's not easy to come back when you're falling behind, particularly in this meta.
Yeah, I mean, I'll say TNC definitely understand the timing windows of a Drow Ranger strategy better than anyone. Also, their draft, even if we think they're outdrafted to some extent, I'm not sure if they are, they drafted much better than last game. Last game, I think they were pretty clearly outdrafted. That said, I think TNC will still be a bit unhappy with this because Teehee got slaughtered in the lane stage. Like, you can look at the end of game and say, oh, 13-1-6 classic Teehee Phantom Lancer, but that does not tell the whole story. And regardless of being at 1-1, again, as opposed to being at 0-2, TNC are not going to want to have a third game in a row where Teehee, their player who usually controls the early game, gets dumpstered in the mid lane.
Yeah, absolutely. I completely agree with you. Granted, it's also worth noting that it might embolden you a little bit, that even if you do end up falling behind, certainly you don't want to make a regular thing of it, but it means that you can come back, and that might give you some, you know, encouragement later on in the series if they end up falling behind, they end up believing in themselves, and end up making it forward in the end. Because I think that, you know, being able to keep up team morale is so important in these types of long series, particularly after you've already had a bit of a long day. Anyways, we're going to be back in just a couple of minutes here with game number three, but stick around after that one even, because we're at least going to be going to four games in this best of five. We'll be right back, guys. Stick around.